ليت يعلن لقد يسوع
سبتني
When the gospel writers state that our blessed Lord cried out this fourth word from the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me? What type of cry was it? Was it a cry of despair? My God, why have you forsaken me? No. Since despair signifies the voluntary refusal to hope in God's promises and the means God provides to obtain the ends which he promised, Christ could not have given in to despair because he underwent his passion with perfect knowledge he was fulfilling God's will. If it was not a cry of despair, was it a cry of damnation then? My God, why have you forsaken me? No. Since damnation signifies the pain of definitive privation of God's grace, knowledge, and vision due to a personal aversion to God's will, Christ could not have experienced damnation in any way because he underwent his passion out of perfect loving obedience to his Father's will. If it was not a cry of despair or damnation, what was it a cry of then? To answer this question, it's helpful first to realize that Jesus' cry was a cry from the opening line of a psalm. Friends, the poet was reciting his own poetry. The singer was singing his own song. And just as when someone today recites the opening lines of a popular song or say national anthem like, O Canada, and it triggers the entire meaning of the national anthem for every faithful Canadian, so too in Jesus' time, to recite the opening line of a psalm like, my God, why have you forsaken me, would have triggered the entire meaning of the psalm for every faithful Jew like Mary and John at the foot of the cross. So a great question is, for our Blessed Mother and the beloved disciple, what was the meaning of this cry? Following St. Thomas Aquinas, Father Thomas Joseph White says that it is best understood as a cry of eschatological desire, in which we can note a both and of extreme suffering in the present moment and perfect hope for future fulfillment. First, Psalm 22 reveals tremendous suffering that Christ experienced, and I encourage you to read Psalm 22, paying particular attention to the experiences of tremendous suffering and apply that to Christ. And when we do, we realize that out of his divine plenitude and perfect knowledge and love, the potential cries of despair and damnation do not relate to Christ in himself, but they relate to us. Jesus heard those potential cries of despair and damnation on Calvary. And that brought him tremendous suffering to think and to know that those potential cries in despair and damnation could be realized in the members of his body. So first, there's tremendous suffering in the present moment, and at the same time, there's tremendous hope for future fulfillment. Psalm 22 is considered a thanksgiving psalm, and Christ had perfect knowledge that he was fulfilling all the prophetic utterances of Psalm 22 in thanking God for deliverance and triumphant victory over sin, death, and Satan. To conclude, Christ's cry of eschatological desire reveals how his perfect act of loving obedience substitutes for our disobedience and heals in our human nature all injustice done to God's loving wisdom by human sin. And because he did it all out of perfect love for the Father and for us, love has the final word. For your personal reflection, I offer you two final thoughts. First, Christ had recourse to Scripture in his greatest moment of suffering. Do you go to Scripture in your suffering? Do you go to the Psalms to teach you how to pray in your times of agony? And second, Christ took his why to God in his pain. Do you take your whys to God? Do you have the courage to address God personally in your pain and the vulnerability to cry out if you feel forsaken by him? Christ has led the way. Now it is our turn. I pray that this fourth word from the cross, my God, why have you forsaken me, may lead you into an imitation of Christ in loving obedience to the Father out of perfect love, and also may give you the courage and vulnerability to address God honestly in your times of prayer. God love you.